the living worth it now.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Covenant of Grace Ministries YouTube channel. I am Reverend Steve Williams, Jr., and I want to send greetings to all of my Covenant of Grace family, our extended COG family, as well as friends and our first-time visitors. We appreciate you all for tuning in today. So before we begin, just a friendly reminder to those who haven't, please subscribe to our YouTube channel. And if you believe that the messages that Pastor Spradley and I are posting on our channel, if it's blessed you, if it's blessed your life and your relationship with Jesus Christ, please take this opportunity to bless someone else by sharing these messages with them, all right? But make sure you allow the Holy Spirit to use you, to lead you and guide you in that decision, okay? All right. Let's get started. We've been focusing over the last 6 weeks on our spiritual battle gear. And so far, we have covered 5 out of the 6 pieces of armor. We've talked about the belt of truth. We've talked about the breastplate of righteousness. We've discussed the shoes of peace, the shield of faith. And last week, we talked about the helmet of salvation. And I was thinking about this teaching series, and I asked the Holy Spirit, I said, Holy Spirit, why stretch this spiritual battle gear topics over such, you know, over these 6 weeks? And why didn't you want me to just do it in a, you know, maybe 3 weeks or something like that? And the Holy Spirit says, because we're in times like this, we don't need a surface understanding of our spiritual battle gear. We need a deeper understanding of our spiritual battle gear in order for us to experience victory in spiritual warfare. He said this, the warfare that we're dealing with is so complex. We cannot just get by with a surface understanding. And so it made me understand how important for me as the teacher to just lead you slowly and make sure that we have a deep understanding of each spiritual battle gear piece. So today we will be teaching on our final item of our battle gear, and that is the sword of the Spirit, the sword of the Spirit. And just to help us see the big picture, as we put all of these pieces of armor together, when we successfully put on the first 3 battle gear items, and we take up, as we talked about, the last 3 battle gear items, and we function effectively with all 6 pieces of armor, we will have what we need to experience true and lasting victory in spiritual warfare, church. So what we're going to do today is we're going to go to our title scripture. It's Ephesians chapter 6, verse 17. As we close out this last piece of spiritual battle gear, Ephesians 6, 17 says, above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Amen. This final piece of armor, the sword of the Spirit, it stands out from all of the other pieces, church. It is unique because it is the only offensive weapon in the arsenal that's used to attack demonic forces, church. All of the other pieces are designed to hold us steady from what the enemy is seeking to bring against us in the evil day. However, church, this weapon, the sword of the Spirit, is used to attack demonic forces and advance against them in spiritual warfare. And what we're going to do today is we're going to break down the key words in this verse, Ephesians 6 and 17. And here's some of the major points we're going to cover today. We're going to talk about what is this sword that Paul is describing in Ephesians 6 and 17. And then we're going to talk about not only about the sword, but that it is the sword of the Spirit. And what does that mean? And then we're going to talk about the three words of God, because the scripture says the sword of Spirit, which is the word of God. And so we're going to give context to what is the word of God. And then finally, we'll close out with how do we use the sword of the Spirit when it comes to spiritual warfare. And we have a beautiful illustration of that today that we're going to share today. So let's start off. What is the sword? What is the sword? So during the time when Peter wrote this letter to the church at Ephesus, Roman soldiers during those times, they used two different types of swords for battle. The first type of sword that they used is what they called a spatha, and that sword was about 3 feet long, all right? The second type of sword that they used in battle was called a gladius, and it was 18 inches long, which is about a foot and a half long. So in the context of Ephesians 6 and 17, Paul instructs us to take the sword of the Spirit. So I guess we need to understand, what sword is he talking about? So the Greek word he uses in the context of Ephesians 6 and 17 is makaira, which refers to the gladius or the smaller sword, okay? So based on the description of this illustration, I would like for all of us, including myself, to remove from our minds the long sword image that we typically think about. You know, we think about that as a result of some of the Zorro movies that we used to watch, or some of our younger followers, the Pirates of the Caribbean movies. You know what I'm talking about? So the gladius is similar to a dagger, okay? And it was used for up close, in your face, hand-to-hand combat with a single opponent. And also, in addition to that, Roman soldiers could also use their gladius when targeting a person unexpectedly and delivering them a deadly blow. So the gladii blades, they were double-edged swords. They were double-edged, and they were needle point sharp, at the point that they had the ability to cause a great amount of physical damage at a quicker rate. And when we think about that double-edged sword, I think a lot of us think about a Hebrews 4 and 12, when it talks about, for the word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword. That word sword, that context in that particular verse is tied to Ephesians 6 and 17. So what we're trying to say is this: a longer sword, during those times, a longer sword didn't do nearly as much damage as the shorter sword. The gladius was used to take folks out permanently. It was a death blow weapon that the Roman soldiers used. So when Paul instructs us to take up the sword of the Spirit, he's basically saying in spiritual warfare, there will be times when the enemy is so close to us that he seems like he's right in our faces. It's like an opponent who's guarding us when we're playing basketball. You know, that defender will stick their hands in our face. They'll put their own face in our face. They'll put their bodies in our face. to prevent us from advancing and scoring a basket, you know. And that's what Satan does to us in the spirit, in spiritual battles, you know. When we are in a spiritual battle, he will bring whatever issue, whatever circumstance we have as close to us as possible. And this oftentimes means, church, that the battle that we're fighting is being waged within our soul, our mind, wills, and emotions, as well as our body. All right. So another thing that Paul talks about and he points out is that this is the sword of the spirit. This is the sword of the spirit. It's not my sword. It's not your sword. It's not the church's sword. It's not the sword of good works and religion. It's not the preacher's sword. This is the sword of the spirit. And it's the only weapon that we're told that the spirit uses in the spirit world. Church, we see that the Holy Spirit uses this sword in heavenly places to deliver a death blow to our enemy. And the key point, church, that we must remember is we can't deliver this blow ourselves. All right? We can't deliver this blow ourselves. When we do, we end up learning the same lesson that Moses and Peter learned when they tried to deliver others with their own strength and with their own power. You see, using our own power will not lead to victory in spiritual warfare. You see, our authority for victory in the spirit world is rooted and grounded in the Lord. It's not by human might. It's not by human power, but it is by his spirit, church. Okay? Now, one of the reasons that many of us are losing our spiritual battles is because we've turned to human philosophy, we've turned to human resources, and we've turned to human methods to battle against someone who is not human. Paul didn't say, take up your sword. He said, take the sword of the Spirit. That means that we must be led by the Spirit and we must walk in the Spirit when we use the sword of the Spirit. When we choose man-made methods to fight in a spiritual battle, you know what happens? We nullify God's grace. We nullify God's power. We nullify God's ability in our battle with spiritual forces. And I want us to look at scripture that supports this. We're going to Romans chapter 12. We'll look at verse 9. We're going to read from the New International Version. Romans 12, verse 19. Scripture says, do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. I want you to also take down a couple other scriptures, James 1 and 20. I'm going to say that again. James 1, chapter 1, verse 20, and Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 35. So when we look at Romans 12 and 19, it says, but leave room. What does that leave room mean? Leave room. Leaving room means to let go of our approach to spiritual battles and letting go of our need to respond with our emotions, church. Okay? We must choose to follow God's approach by aligning our emotions underneath his overarching rule and putting on his full armor. And I thought about this during the week. I said, Lord, why do we tend to struggle letting go? Why do we struggle so much with it? And the Holy Spirit told me this, and it was so true. It was so profound. It spoke so clear to me. Holy Spirit says, he said, because, Steve, he said, my people have not believed in the power of the sword. And I said, you're right. We don't believe. We don't, our faith, we don't place our faith in the power of the sword. Holy Spirit said, we, and he was talking about us, the church, we lack faith in our spiritual dagger because we don't get a chance to see the enemy get sliced and diced as we think he ought to be. Amen. But here's the point that we need to recognize. And this is what settled it, just settled and put me at peace. There is so much power in the sword of the Spirit that God supplied it to us as our only offensive weapon. Isn't that something? Ooh, that's powerful. And church, I truly believe that Jesus is saying to us today that his grace that he's provided to us with the sword of the Spirit is sufficient to stand alone as the only offensive weapon in our spiritual battle gear. I want us to take that. I really want us to take that to heart. Amen. Praise God. We're going to continue. We're going to talk about the last part of Ephesians 6:17. He says, the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And so in order for us to understand what the word of God is in context of this particular verse in Ephesians 6:17, what we need to do is we need to break down the different Greek terms that are used for God's word. And so here are the three terms used for God's word. The first term that's used is graphai, which is the written word of God. The second Greek term that's used for God's word is logos. Logos is the message of the word of God. The third word that's used for God's word is rhema, and that is the spoken word of God. So we're going to break each one of these Greek words down and give a deeper understanding of what they mean. So let's go to graphai. First word that's used for the word of God. And we know that this means the writings of God, the Holy Spirit, the Holy Scriptures, the Bible. And we're going to look at 2 Timothy in chapter 3, verse 16 and 17, because this particular verse uses graphe in the term of, in the context of this particular scripture. Scripture says, as 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17, it says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God, is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. All right. So when Paul says to take the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, he's not referring to graphai. However, and this is what we have to recognize, many people today believe this is what Paul is talking about. And the reason why the Holy Spirit has me to say this is because when we look at people's life choices and the choices that they make, you can see that their choices are made based on the graphe word. But and here's an example. Many people look to the Bible today as if it were a lucky charm or a rabbit's foot or a four-leaf clover, thinking that it alone brings about the power needed to live a life of victory in a fallen world, you know? And I'm gonna give an example. Placing a Bible in our car won't prevent us from having a car accident, okay? Burying Bibles all over our property won't prevent someone from breaking into our home, you know? And I don't want anybody to misunderstand me. What we're saying is I'm not saying that the Bible isn't powerful or essential for everyone. It is powerful. It is essential for everyone. But in order for it to accomplish its purpose, church, it needs to be used properly. And many people today aren't using the Bible properly. And that's why they're thinking the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God, is a graphe. You know, the Bible shouldn't just be present in our homes and sitting on a shelf collecting dust. The key point we need to understand is this. When the graphe is not being used correctly, there is no power associated with it. It's merely just words on a page. It's merely just words on a page. Think about it. I think about this, when people who go to court and they're told, I don't even know if they still do this or not. When people go to court and they're told to put their hand on the Bible, excuse me. And the justice system doesn't use the message in the Bible for their rulings when they make rules and when they place judgment on people. If they did, things would look a whole lot different in our world today. The justice system uses the Bible because people associate truth-telling with the graphe, okay? So I hope we've gained a better understanding of graphe and the importance of us using the graphe appropriately in order to experience the power that it can bring to our lives. So let's talk about the second word of God, and that is the message of God, logos. And logos means the message of the book or the meaning of the word of God. So when we read the Bible, when we listen to a Bible study or we hear a sermon that explains the meaning of the text that's being referenced, we are experiencing and interacting with logos. And I'm going to give you a scripture that uses logos in its context, and that's the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verse 1. And this scripture we know is talking about Jesus because Jesus is the Word made flesh, and he is the Word. And so scripture says in John 1 and 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So Jesus is called the Logos because he was sent as God's messenger to present God to mankind and to embody his message to us, church. Graphe is the message written, and logos is the message given. I'm going to say that again. Graphe is the message written, and logos is the message given. So logos is the understanding of the written record of events, stories, and letters that we come into contact with within God's written word. So I'm going to give you another context, and this is a scripture I mentioned a little bit earlier because it was talking about sword. The context of this particular passage ties to logos. That's Hebrews chapter 4. We're going to look at verses 12 and 13. Hebrews 4, 12 and 13, New International Version. And it says, for the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to the dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of him to whom we must give account. All right, let's go into this word. Logos is used in this context and is talking about the word of God being alive and active. So logos is a force with energy behind it, given to accomplish a specific goal, to divide our spirit and soul, and it has the ability to divide that soul and that new spirit that God places in us. So this is important to us, church, in achieving victory, because there's so many times when our soul gets in the way of our spirit, when we let our mind, when we let our will, when we let our emotions get in the way of our spirit. Our feelings, our thoughts, our upbringing, our culture that we were raised in, our desires can keep God's presence, his truth, and his power from functioning freely in us, church. And many times our struggles, to be honest with you, many times our struggles aren't with outside forces, but it's mostly within internal. It's the forces that we deal with within. And we can overcome those internal forces by allowing God's spirit to dominate our souls, as we've been taught. Okay? Now, not only does the logos divide between spirit, soul, and spirit, church, but he's also able to discern and judge both the thoughts and the intentions of the heart. Okay? He does not just address the action, but he attends to our heart and mind, which propel the action. Okay. The logos just doesn't say to forgive someone or to put that drink down or to delete that app on our phone or to change the channel that we're watching. You know, it goes deeper and it focuses on the why behind the what. Okay. Because getting the why rightly aligned underneath the truth and the message of God, you know what that does? It motivates us to stop doing those things that are outside the will of the Father. So when we go back and we looked at the scripture, it talks about that whatever logo sees, God sees, right? So when we think about the word of God opens us up to reveal all things within us. The word of God makes us transparent, okay? And that's why that word of God, that's why it's the truth. And then we talked about this when we talked about the belt and the belt of truth. What it does, it exposes us. It makes us transparent in God. And it allows us to be authentic with him. It's almost like a spiritual x-ray or a spiritual MRI that shows inner truth that outward actions don't always reveal, you know? Because if you think about it, we can have good actions, but have a bad heart, right? We can do good things, but our heart can be bad. we could have a bad heart problem. Or there are times when we can have bad actions, but have a good heart and be repentant and recognize our need for mercy and recognize our need for dependence on the Lord. And there was a parable that Jesus spoke in the Gospel of Luke. I think it was Luke chapter 18. And he talked, and it was about the two men that went to pray at the temple. There was a Pharisee and there was a tax collector. And the Pharisee prayed first, and he began comparing himself as being better than other people who were sinners, you know, and making himself look big while putting others down. And then the tax collector, he, instead of him, you know, when he got up to pray, he sought mercy from the Lord. And Jesus responded by saying, those who exalt themselves will be humble, but those who humble themselves will be exalted. So here's the point. As we meditate on fully understanding God's truth, and we allow the logos of God to penetrate and take root deep within us, it reveals, church, it reveals our hearts to such a degree that not only that we're able to discern right from wrong, but also truth from a lie. And it penetrates so deeply. And the beautiful thing about it is it creates a powerful impact on our lives. So now we're going to talk about the last word that represents the word of God. And this is the Rhema word of God. I know Pastor Brandon Spradley speaks on this a lot. And I want to go into this word and talk about this Rhema word. And this Rhema word is actually the word that is used in Ephesians 6 and 17. It means utterance, or spoken word that has been declared by faith. So graphe represents the written word. Logos represents the message of the written word. And rhema is the specific declaration concerning the message of the written word. So here's what we need everyone to understand. Okay, we can have 100 Bibles in our home, but never have the power of the sword of the Spirit. We can have a PhD in theology and possess a great understanding of the message in the scriptures, but still not utilize the power of the sword against the enemy. The sword of the Spirit specifically refers to the Rhema of God, which is our only offensive weapon that we use to advance against the enemy. And church, there, the reason so many of disciples of Jesus Christ, the reason why so many of us are living defeated lives is because many of us haven't graduated from graphe to logos to rhema. You know, some of us are stuck in graphe mode, all right? We just bring our Bibles or our Bible apps on our phone to church, and we may or may not use it. Or if we do, we may read a verse or so. You know, the Bible is just a book, or it's just an app to us, unless we open it up, we read it, and we hear God's Spirit, our divine teacher, teach us and speak to us through it. That's when it becomes more than just a book. Amen. All right. Many of us are also, we're stuck in logos land. Many of us are stuck in logos land. We understand the sermons that we hear. We attend Bible studies and we take notes on the knowledge that has been shared with us. But the part that we miss out on, and this is so many, and I'm speaking to all of us, not just speaking to people, I'm speaking to all of us collectively. What we fail to do is we fail to use what we've learned in spiritual warfare against the enemy. And I think all of us have a challenge to get better at this. You see, because just having an understanding isn't good enough when we're in battle with the enemy. Church, we know how much spiritual warfare we're facing in this world, in this season that we're in today. When we are in battle with the enemy and all hell is broken loose in our lives, church, when we are facing difficult times like this, we need a Rhema word in us. All right? We need to hear Yahweh speak to us, and we need to hear that his truth straight from our hearts. Straight into the heart. We need to be speaking his truth straight into the heart of Satan and his demons, church. That word needs to be in us, and we need to pronounce it to the enemy. I want us to grasp that. That is our weapon. Some of us, and I want us to remember, some of us probably don't know this, but many of us, we've had a Rhema word experience, but we probably didn't know it was a Rhema word. You know, so many of us have read a passage in the Bible, or we've sat and listened to a message that was preached. We've read it ourselves. We've either read the word, we've heard a word, or we've spoken a word, and something in our spirit connects with the word that was spoken. And it's in that connection, it seems as though God is literally speaking his word to us. That's that Rhema word experience. And when we get a word like that, we're supposed to take that word and we're supposed to pronounce that word when we need it in that time. So to help us in our spiritual battle. And here's another part about this Rhema word. See, this Rhema word has creative power. And we're going to look at this creative power that the Rhema word provides. It's in Genesis 1 and 3. We're talking about creation here. And it says, and God says, let there be light. And there was light. So that Rhema spiritual dagger, that spoken word possessed the power to accomplish God's desire and bring things into beings. He was created. This was the verse that God used as he began the creation of the earth. But what he used to create was words, the power of words. We've heard Pastor Spradley talked about the creative power of words. Church, we as sons and daughters of Yahweh, as sons of daughters of the Lord, we have that same ability, all right? And this is why Satan is always trying to get us to question God's word. You know, when we get God's word twisted, instead of it becoming a double-edged sword, it becomes a dull sword that's unable to carry out its purpose. And we saw Satan twist up God's word in the Garden of Eden, in Genesis 3 and 1, with Eve. You know, when Satan he played a serpent, right? And he asked Eve, did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden? He said that question because he knew that if he could confuse God's words to Eve, that he would reduce the power that she and Adam possessed to defeat him, okay? Satan loves, he loves when we use our own intellect or others' opinions as truth, because there is no power in our own opinions, there's no power in our own truth. But when we begin to say, well, God says that no weapon that is formed against me shall prosper. That's when we say that, that's when Satan starts to moonwalk. Because what we're doing when we say that is we're jabbing him with the sword of the spirit, and he has no match, church. He has no match against that powerful force of the utterance of God. Amen. So let's look at an example of how we use the sword of the spirit in spiritual warfare. We're going to look at a passage. We're not going to go through all of it. What I want you to do is I want you to read this entire passage in Matthew 4. I think it's from verse 1 to verse 11. But we're going to just cover verses 1 through 4 today. This is Jesus, and I know you're familiar. This is when he was tempted in the wilderness. Scripture says, Matthew 4 and 1 says, then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness and to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, if you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread. Jesus answered, it is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. Okay. So the beginning in verse 1, it talks about the Holy Spirit, how he leads Jesus in the spiritual warfare against Satan. All right. And now we're about to see Jesus put his sword of the spirit. He's already got his spiritual battle gear on, and he's about to put his sword of the spirit into practice to defeat the enemy. And then verse 2 and 3 talks about, you notice, after fasting for 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. That's when Satan came to him to tempt him. And notice, and this is the part we need to recognize, Satan will come up against us when we're at our weakest moment, church, because Satan loves to attack us during these times, okay? These are some times, and Pastor Spradley taught us about this a while ago. He talked about Satan's opportune time to come up against us is when we're hungry, when we're angry, when we're lonely, when we're tired. That's the halt method, right? Hungry, angry, lonely, tired. Jesus fasted for 40 days, church, and he was hungry. And his desire for hunger, his hunger desire was legitimate, right? It was a legitimate desire. There's nothing wrong with being hungry. And so verse 4, you know, so, you know, Satan was asking him to turn the stones into bread. So Jesus responded to him and said, it is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Jesus responds, and we need to pay close attention to what he did. He didn't use his time to debate with Satan or have a long dialogue with him, right? But what he did do, church, was this. He said, it is written. He used the full force of the word and word of God, and he stated what God said in his word. And Jesus spoke God's word. He spoke his Father's word in faith, and he didn't respond to Satan's bait. He believed in his Father's word. He believed that his Father's word was true despite how hungry he felt in that moment, church. That is so profound. And we know that Jesus was tested. He was tempted 2 more times after this first attempt, and Jesus responds to Satan in the same way. He responds by saying, it is written, and he followed that it is written by what God's word said about the matter. So here's the question for us. Now, if the living word, Jesus Christ, if he needed to use the rhema to deal with the enemy, how much more must we, as his disciples, rely on the rhema of God? You see, Jesus didn't approach Satan based on his personal thoughts. Jesus overcame with the word of God. And if we don't have a sound understanding of the word of God, then how can we respond to Satan's attacks by responding with a proper word for the matter that we are facing? An example I want to share with you. If we're having thoughts of fear, we don't need to be speaking a word of prosperity. We shouldn't be saying to combat thoughts of fear and that's in us. We shouldn't combat that by saying, "My God shall supply all my need according to his riches and glory." If we have a spirit of fear that's in us, we need to be combating it with a word that says, God says that he did not give me a spirit of fear, but he gave me power. He gave me love, and he gave me a sound mind. When we're pressed with fear, we should say, "There is no fear in love, because perfect love casts out all fear, because fear hath torment." Amen. Here's another point. Jesus had a legitimate need, all right? Being hungry was a legitimate need, and Satan didn't twist Christ's need, all right? What he did do is he twisted the way Jesus would meet that need, okay, by tempting Jesus to try to fulfill it apart from God. And that's what Satan tries to do with us at times. And when Satan did this, when he tried to twist how Jesus would meet that need, Jesus responded by Googling God's provision program, okay? And he told Satan what God's word said about food and hunger. And notice, Satan tested Jesus three times during this battle, this spiritual battle. But if you read down in verse 11, it says that after that third time, the scripture says Satan left until another opportune time. And this is what I want you to understand, church. Don't think just because we win a spiritual battle that Satan won't show up at our door anymore. He will be coming back when he sees us in a weak state again. So we're going to close out. All right. The sword of the Spirit is our only offensive weapon to advance against the enemy in the trials and battles he has brought upon us, church. So, church, we need, as the song says, as CC says it, let's wage war against Satan and take back our territory, church. Let's take back our territory and restore what has been lost as a result of his deceptive strategies. When we put on that full armor of God, yet let's use the sword of the Spirit to move forward against the enemy and tell him that he has to flee. He has to get out of our way, church. And as Paul encourages us in Romans chapter 8, verse 37, he says, "In all things," church, "we are more than conquerors through him," through Christ, "who loves us." All right? Church, let's make the choice. Let's declare today. Let's choose to use our spiritual battle gear so that we can be more than conquerors and experience true victory right here on earth in spiritual warfare. Spiritual warfare. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. What a word. What a word. What a word. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for being our teacher today. One thing I want to let you know is this. It's been a pleasure just teaching on the spiritual battle gear. If you've missed a message, a piece of spiritual battle gear message, please go back and listen to it. They all connect. and they are so important. And we need our spiritual battle gear, especially in the times that we're facing now. And don't think we're out of the woods yet. There's more to come. Don't think that even though you've won, that Satan's not going to come back at you, because he will be back. But we have to be prepared, and we have to make sure that we put on and we take up our spiritual battle gear. Amen. Each and every, that's a daily choice that we have to make. All right. Just want to also say that for those of you who are asking about sowing into the ministry, there's going to be some information shared at the outro of the video that tells you a couple of ways that you can give. It's not no pressure at all, because we want those that want to plant a seed, we want you to give cheerfully as the Holy Spirit leads you to do. If you have any questions and you want to us to give you feedback on the messages, you can email us. The email is cogministries2018@gmail.com. I'm going to say it again, cogministries2018@gmail.com. If you got any questions on the messages that we're presenting on YouTube, and you want to get feedback from us with your questions, just send us an email, and we'll be more than happy to assist you. Amen. I want to wish everyone a blessed Thanksgiving. And just remember, I know even though we're in the season that we're in, a lot of us are used to being together with family, and we don't have that opportunity to do so. Just understand this. Even in the midst of the things that we're dealing with today, there is still so much. There's so much for us to be thankful for, despite all that's happened, church. And so we must put our focus on what we do have, and not focus on the things that we don't have or we're not able to do as a result of the season that we're in. And hopefully that gives us a new perspective. Amen. And just continue to have a daily walk of thanksgiving. So we're going to close out with our prayer and do our benediction. All right. Heavenly Father, we thank you today, Lord. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your unfailing love. We thank you, Father, for your Spirit, Father, who is our divine teacher that has been bringing forth the messages today on our spiritual battle gear. Father, help us to put on our full armor of God, that belt of truth, the breastplate of righteousness, the shoes of peace, the shield of faith, the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the spirit, which is your word, which is that rhema word, the spoken word of God, that we use as an offensive weapon to fight the enemy's attacks against us. Father, help us to remember, Lord, that in all things that we are more than conquerors through you, Lord, who loved us. And this is why the scripture tells us that in everything that we give thanks, because you have already provided everything that we need in spiritual places. And we give thanks to you, Father. We give honor to you. We give glory to you, not for what you do, but we thank you for being who you are, our Abba Father. We appreciate the relationship, our personal relationship we have with you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now we do our benediction. May the love of God, may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of us until we have the blessed opportunity to come together in Christian fellowship. And all of God's people said with a prayer of agreement, amen. All right. Love you all. Have a blessed week and a blessed Thanksgiving. Take care.